Hey, what's going on? This is Pastor Nate, and we started a special segment called Boss Talk. And what I'm going to be doing is just interviewing different business owners, people who I respect, people I call for advice, people who can help you if you're trying to be an entrepreneur or if you already have a business and just want to know how can you make your business grow. Our first guest ever is a friend of mine. I've known him for 16 plus years. And when I first heard his story, have you ever met somebody before? You see them at a level and then you hear their story and you never knew how much they have went through to do what they do. Sometimes people can make it look easy. And our first guest, Mr. Carl Webb, has made it look easy, but he has a story and we believe that it's going to be a blessing to you. Mr. Webb, how you doing?
I'm fantastic. So and welcome I am to glad.
First segment of Boss Talk, and so
what a name, Boss Talk.
Boss Talk, you know, it's a, I'm trying to stay relevant, so my kids say all these things, and sometimes I use it in context, and sometimes I don't. And they say, Dad, just stay what you know, just stay with I'm chilling, just staying with right. dope, so I don't try to do any other stuff because
Trust
it don't
me,
sound
I understand.
Right. Yeah, I don't put it together right, but in this culture, a boss. What they say is somebody who's a business person, who's an owner, somebody who's kind of doing their own thing in a good way. And there's somebody, you're somebody I respect in that manner. And so just wanted to get together and have a conversation with
Great.
You.
I'm excited about this. I love, you know, the time that we have together. We are often in crossing paths and we really don't have a moment to just sort of sit down and chop it up.
Yes, sir.
But I love you. I love the energy that you bring to everything that you do. And even when I don't see you in such a way that we can sit down and talk, I see that you're always about getting things done.
Yep.
And
yes,
so I'm looking forward to our chat today.
Appreciate it. Thank you. So I didn't have to, but I looked at your bio, kind of like, is there anything about Mr. Webb that I don't know? And you know, people call you Carl. I've called you Mr. Webb ever since I know you, just as a respect factor. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to continue that.
Mm-hmm.
But I said, is there anything about you I don't know? And there wasn't. One of the questions, first questions I wanted to pose to you is, your expertise for schooling seems like it's in marketing. But then when I think of you and all that I know and things that you do in business, it seems like you don't do any marketing. What would you say that you do?
Well, you know, the background is one that began with marketing, more so graphic design and marketing communication. I actually went to art school. And so I've been able to now spend 38 years as an entrepreneur in business for myself. About 25 of those years were in the marketing, public relations industry. And part of the reason that I took that route was, quite frankly, coming out of high school, that was really the thing that I was most gifted at, was art. Being creative. And it was once I started getting exposed to some programs at North Carolina Central, some summer enrichment. Yeah, some enrichment programs to help sort of expose me to art as a career. And in that vein, it was much more in the area of fine arts. And it was later that I started
to describe fine arts.
Fine arts is, you know, paint on canvas, drawing.
Okay.
And you know, the funny thing is that many of the artists in that fine art space, you know, you're talking about the idea of starving artists.
Okay.
And that just wasn't working for me, you know. And the difference with commercial art was that was more, you know, developing advertisements, you know, be it newspaper, magazine, or radio, television ads. And so that was a bit more intriguing, and it was, you know, it was a little cooler as well. Although, you know, being an artist was super cool
as well. It was cool,
dude. You know, and I really needed to accelerate my plans because, you know, coming out of high school, you know, I came out with some challenges and really hadn't been a very good student, quite honestly. And you know, what turned out to be the love of my life, I met in a world history class. And you know, fortunately we got together, unfortunately we got together too soon and became teenage parents.
Okay.
So although I wasn't really prepared for a traditional college experience, I had to get ready very, very quickly.
Now, what age did you become a teenage parent?
I was about 16 and a half, and my girlfriend, now wife, she was 15 when we had our first child. So that gave me a certain kind of focus, mm-hmm. in all of the right ways. And as I mentioned, you know, not being as committed to school, mm-hmm. and not because I didn't enjoy school. It just wasn't part of the tradition. I am one of nine kids,
okay.
and a couple of my siblings had gone on to college, mm-hmm. but it wasn't. And I'm like the knee baby.
Okay.
So I was more interested in the arts and being creative, but when you become a teenage father, right. life gets serious quick.
So how are you able to rebound? Like, how were you able to go from being in school to becoming a father to staying focused and doing what you're doing now, or not doing what you're doing now,
sure.
going into that first phase of marketing? How are you able to do that?
Well, it was a long journey.
Okay.
As I mentioned, you know, I'm celebrating about 38 years now, you know, in mm-hmm. the game. So none of this stuff happens overnight. And I was fortunate to have a lot of influential people in my, mm-hmm. my life during that season.
Okay.
And trying to find myself.
Mm-hmm.
I had some friends. There was a very good friend of mine, a guy by the name of Kay Hardaway,
okay.
and his brother Thomas Hardaway. And, you know, they had lived, in both black, they had lived a different kind of a lifestyle than I had.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we came up, we were working class people. You know, didn't have great resources. We, you know, solid family.
Mm-hmm.
But I interacted with a lot of kids that had greater resources,
okay.
and greater exposures.
Okay.
And I think that helped shape me early on to at least show me what was possible. And then, you know, I was fortunate in that we had good guidance counselors, school teachers. You know, Bridget was a lot more gifted. And in every way.
I think that's both our cases.
Yeah. I mean, I did well. And I think the teachers were committed to making sure that she didn't get off track,
mm-hmm.
and especially that I didn't mess up her life.
Oh, man.
And,
yeah.
But then I had teachers who were committed to me as well.
Wow.
And again, you know, arts and
what
the
do you mean by committed to you?
Committed to you and knowing that you could be better than you were
wow.
presenting yourself.
That's good.
Committed and to you in a way that, you know, you became the president of the art club,
mm-hmm.
not just because of your talent,
mm-hmm.
but because your teacher saw something
in
you, but knew that if she gave you some responsibility,
mm-hmm.
you would take things a little bit more seriously.
Absolutely.
In the choir, I sung at all levels in the choir,
mm-hmm.
and the choir director and choir teacher, Miss Timberlake, you know, she made sure that she gave me a platform to be included, and she expected me to perform and to
wow.
produce. And so that helped me. And then when it came time to start looking at schools and what to do, that's when the counselors were like, yeah, we know that you're not a superlative kind of a student,
mm-hmm.
but we're gonna help you find some paths. Bridget, on the other hand, she was like kicking butt from the beginning to end. She went on to Carolina and, you know, she was doing her thing. And I went to Atlanta and went to art school and did my thing.
Uh-huh.
So the way that it happened was family, teachers, her parents, you know, we were fortunate in that we were both raised by, you know, a two-parent household.
Mm-hmm.
My dad was committed to making sure that I did the right thing. My mom was, you know, just God's gift to every aspect of
mm-hmm.
my life, and she was going to make sure that I took care of my responsibilities as well. Now, Bridget's family, on the other hand, they weren't too pleased about how I had complicated their lives,
right.
and it was certainly not the plan that they had for their daughter.
Right.
in the ninth grade
mm-hmm.
To become pregnant.
Right.
And so it took quite some time
mm-hmm.
for them to appreciate me.
Right.
And in many ways, the fact that her father didn't care much for me during that time.
Uh-huh.
Now, keep in mind, I have two daughters.
Right.
And I can better appreciate exactly how he felt now over time.
Right.
But it was that challenge from another man that also caused me to focus and mm-hmm. really lean into, I'm going to prove you wrong.
So you said there was accelerated. So where did you go from marketing to what you do now? What was that transition like?
Well, you know, when I got to Atlanta for school, first of all, you know, I paid for my own education along with, you know, some financial aid. Mm-hmm. I was able to get an apartment in relatively short order once I got there.
This is all being a teenage father.
This is all being a teenage father.
Wow.
And I was able to get a job. And the reason that that happened is that those programs that I was participating in at North Carolina Central during mm-hmm. the summer helped prepare me. And then I worked for Service Printing Company, which at the time was a very historic and well-known black printing company. At its peak, it was the largest black okay. printing company in the state. And so that was a formative time for me. That was really important for me to understand mm-hmm. entrepreneurship. It was a chance for me to see what it took to run a business.
Okay.
And even though they were dealing with some old technology mm-hmm. back in the day, because I had to learn the fundamentals of printing and design and those types of mm-hmm. things, when I went to Atlanta, I had marketable skills that enabled me to get a job very quickly. Now,
okay.
going into commercial arts, visual communications at that time, there were very few black people in the field.
Okay.
And so part of the reason when I did come back to North Carolina, I ended up eventually starting my own firm, my first firm.
And what was that?
That was advertising communications.
Okay.
And part of that came because I couldn't find a job in an advertising agency.
So you started your own.
So I did a short stint with a design firm in okay. the Research Triangle Park. And it was not being a designer, it was actually sales, business development. During the interview, the owner said, "Man, you know, you do such a great job presenting your ideas and stuff, and we really don't have a graphic design job. But have you ever thought about sales?"
Wow.
And you know,
so it's kind of like you had in mind one thing: this is what I want to do. But within that, you were getting training for what you would ultimately do.
Yeah, absolutely. And I was hungry. I was a little disenchanted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you work in a larger market like I did mm-hmm. in Atlanta. You come back. I came back because I was afraid I was going to lose Bridget. You know, she was over there, and I think Michael Jordan was there when she was there. Sam Perkins was there, and she had a sweet mate that I think may have even gone out or something, been friends with Sam Perkins. Like, look, I need to get back. And then also my daughter, I just couldn't deal with the idea of any other man or anybody
right.
raising my daughter. And I wanted to do the right thing, but I knew I had to have the ability to do that. So I did what I had to do because I needed to prove my then soon to be father-in-law mm-hmm. wrong.
Right.
I need to not lose my girl.
Right.
And I needed to make my daughter proud.
Right.
And irrespective of the fact that I couldn't get a design job, I started sales. And that was a life-changing moment because that was what gave me the access to relationships that then led me to my first investor when it was revealed that
right.
I wanted to start my own business.
So what was the business that you started in a home or in your home? I remember your daughter, when you got the award and I was there, she's like, "I can remember riding
yeah.
a bike at the business," which was
yeah.
our home, being
yeah.
in a, so what was that? Is that the?
Well, that was a different time.
Okay.
That was, you know, often people share with you the highlights of their career. And, that time that I had to reset
mm-hmm.
and work from home was about 10 years
okay.
after I had started my first business, probably a little bit longer,
okay.
Actually. And I hit rock bottom. You know, I had to regroup. I made a couple of young mistakes
uh-huh.
and found myself needing to relaunch.
Okay.
had to shut that business down and operate from home.
Wow.
And that was humbling.
Mm.
I was fortunate in that Bridget, like I said, she's the best decision mm-hmm. I ever made. She's always held things down.
You That's
know,
good.
She went into the healthcare field. And you know, as a registered nurse, she always had options, although she spent not a lot of time in the hospitals because she was able to work other jobs within the
right.
industry, but it provided some stability. But I regrouped. I set up an operation from my home in the room over the garage. Again, my daughter had to see me pick up the pieces, put myself back together mm-hmm. again. And I relaunched.
So what sustained you, like, during those times, like from making progress to going backwards, making progress to going backwards? What made you continue to feel like I'm a businessman? That's what I'm going to do.
Well, as I mentioned to you before, service printing company that I worked for when I was in high school and during the summers,
mm-hmm.
Nat White Senior. Was a man of pride and integrity.
Mm-hmm.
And so he helped me to believe that I could be a businessman. And it was sort of looking back on the experiences that I picked up from him.
Mm-hmm.
I remember times when I had to, we had to race to the bank to get our checks cashed because there were times that not everybody's check was going to clear.
Oh, wow.
But yet and still, I respected his hustle,
mm-hmm.
you know? And so I knew that even in tough times, you just keep on pushing.
Right.
So when I started going through, it didn't stop me
mm-hmm.
because I knew that was inherent in business, that you're gonna have some ups and downs. Certainly it hit my pride,
mm.
you know, and I felt bad about myself. And the great thing that my mother gave me as part of the inheritance that she's left for her children
mm-hmm.
and her children's children. It wasn't and hasn't been so much financial wealth, although she left some,
right.
and which is an interesting story too, not much, but what she left was a belief and a faith in God.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was at the beginning and through every aspect of my life, my mother gave me that inheritance
mm-hmm.
of a faith and a belief in something greater than myself.
Mm.
So even when I was going through those tough times and those times when I was in my in those prideful moments,
right.
feeling myself
right.
as the young people would say, and I messed up, you know, because I believed that I could do things the way that the world did things,
mm-hmm.
and it didn't work for me.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the faith and an ability to pray and to do what my mother taught me
right.
that got me through.
So I remember the first time I met you, and it's probably 15 years ago, and we were doing this golf tournament. You and Vic and I, and he said, Carl's gonna help us. And I said, who's Carl? He said, oh, I gotta introduce you, Carl. He's great, man. And then you would come in and we have a meeting. You say, hey, I gotta go, I got another meeting.
Right.
And that happened for a while. I think we did two tournaments together.
Yep.
And then Dorian Bolden
yep.
at BU Cafe. I remember over there on Highway 55.
Uh-huh.
And he was trying to get his business together.
Yeah, we helped him.
And
jump
we were
off.
Sitting outside
yep.
in this outside little patio.
Yep.
And we would meet like every other Thursday.
Yep.
And I was like, why are they keep listening to,
yeah.
who is Carl Webb? Who
yeah.
is Carl Webb? And then we got into a relationship and came friends. And you were just Carl Webb to me.
Yeah.
You were somebody who Vic introduced me to. I knew your wife. And then I looked and they said, oh, that's Greenfire. And I was like, oh, it's.
Yeah.
Because you gave me a card and you
yeah.
gave me a pen
okay.
in one of the meetings. And I was like, what? What does he do? Who is he? And so what is it that you do?
Well, what I do now.
What do you do now?
After the marketing and advertising and all of that.
Now, did you do South Point first? Or you did
South Point, Streets of South Point was one of my clients.
Okay.
Okay. And so that was what happened in the marketing and PR world. I got a chance to work with, you know, GlaxoSmithKline, R.J. Reynolds back in the day when tobacco was still okay.
Uh-huh.
Did a lot of stuff with the Tom Joyner Morning Show,
mm-hmm.
Urban Retail Properties, which is the developer of the Streets at South Point Mall.
Okay.
And so when they came to town and a number of other developers, especially in Durham, they needed to build relationships and build them quickly. Mm-hmm. And I had relationships.
Right.
And I also had skills that we could bring to the table as well. And it was sort of watching developers grow and change mm-hmm. Durham that I was like, man, this is great. And I would do good work for them. They would love me. Streets of South Point gave me, you know, a bonus at the end of the project when the mall opened.
Now, what was your responsibility for that?
Public relations,
okay.
marketing,
okay.
and government relations.
Okay.
Helping to get them through the approval process.
Okay.
You may not remember, but it was a very contentious project. There were a lot of people in the community, especially environmentalists, that didn't want to see the mall built, didn't mm-hmm. want the trees to come down.
Okay.
And my job was to put together a strategy to gain the community support that they needed for the approval, as well as provide the kind of information to the elected officials to vote their way, and we won.
Gotcha.
And so that was a great moment. And so it was through that that I started to understand how impactful development was. It was also at that point that I started to think about generational wealth mm-hmm. and what real wealth was about.
Mm. What's real wealth?
Real wealth is the kind of wealth that lasts generations.
Okay.
It's the kind of money that is generated off of the work that you and the investments that you have made 10, 20 years mm-hmm. ago mm-hmm. and that money is making. But what it was to me was the money that is being made while you're at home having a cup of coffee.
Okay.
It's the money that's being made when you take your family to the beach. It's the money that's being made when you sign the front side of the check as opposed to the back side of the check. And that money, a lot of people that look like you and I know nothing about.
Now, so I'm always intrigued with your story. So I know I'm skipping. I know I asked you what you do. Then we over here with money. So I want to stay right there in that vein. So what would be your suggestion for somebody who's first generation, like growing up in Chapel Hill, see a lot of African-Americans with that type of wealth? I didn't see a lot. I mean, and not in a bad way, but I went to school with trust fund kids.
Sure.
I went to the school with the guy, his grandfather is the one who did I-40.
Uh-huh.
The Keenans,
mm-hmm.
the Greenberg. I mean, so I saw that where, hey, why are you going to University of Georgia? Oh, because my dad said I have to go there because, you know, we're going to do this and this and this. That they get a check, and it's their check, but it's not their real check. It's a check that somebody... So what would be your suggestion for somebody that's like a first generation trying to create generational wealth? Their parents haven't left them anything. They're saying, you know what? I'm trying to be like Carl Webb. I'm trying to produce. I'm trying to, you know, I'm trying to do that for my family. Like, what would be your suggestion?
The reason I laugh is, you know, being fully transparent, I don't want to give anyone the impression that I'm sitting here rolling in dough and it's about money.
Sure.
That's really not what I'm saying. I'm talking about these concepts and ideas. I've probably lost as much money as I've made in my career. And when you hear most people talk about, you know, being a millionaire or having millions, at some point in time, we all mm-hmm. will have millions. Mm-hmm. I mean, just look at the average salary right now. Most people are making six figures, and mm-hmm. you know, over 10 years, if you're making $100,000, mm-hmm. you're gonna have $1 million.
Right.
Okay?
I think the thing that intrigues me so much about you is, as long as I've known you, it's two things. Like, you seem like a risk taker, because you, from the time I've known you, you've like gone from something that I felt like, oh, this is really great, to like, oh, he's not doing that anymore.
Well, yeah, and part of that is because the opportunity shift. Mm-hmm. And
one opportunity shift.
That's right, because what happened with representing these developers, I started to realize that I was creating value that I wasn't able to maximize.
Wow.
And the only way that I could maximize the value that I created, like if you make Now Church the spot,
mm-hmm.
when you leave, somebody needs to compensate you for that effort.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just that simple.
Right.
I mean, you took it from nothing and you made it. What happens if you just say to the next guy, oh, don't worry about it. You know, God told me to just give it to you.
Mm-hmm.
He may tell you that, but you're leaving wealth behind. You're leaving value that you help create behind.
What's maximized value?
Well, it's first of all, understanding what your value is.
Okay.
So if you have a project and it needs a certain kind of approval, mm-hmm. or it needs capital, and you're able to find that money, mm-hmm. or you're able to get the necessary rezoning and approval, what's the real value of that? Mm-hmm. Is it the hourly rate that they pay you? Or is it that residual income that investment is gonna generate for them?
Gotcha.
If I bring an investor to the table, am I gonna just get a fee, a finder's fee, mm-hmm. or am I gonna get a percentage of the deal?
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes any percent is better than no percent and a fee.
Okay.
Now when you do that, you take risk. Mm. Stuff may not work.
So when you were doing South Point, one of the things that you said—
Now understand, South Point, it was a fee for service. I was working, they were paying me. I had staff that worked with them there. They were paying me a fee. I wasn't a developer. I was a advisor and consultant with them, and I was learning.
Gotcha.
So that was the relationship that I had. So and that was one of the things that I learned. When I finished that project, I was done.
Right.
They were just beginning.
Right. Oh, okay.
That the money was just starting to make it. But you know, that's a big project. That was, you know, a ginormous project. And now everything else that you see that I've been involved with, I have an ownership interest.
Okay. So what was Greenfire?
So Greenfire is we acquired over almost 30 properties in downtown Durham.
Okay.
And in each of those properties, I had an ownership interest. I was an owner in the portfolio of Greenfire.
Okay.
The building that you sit in, that we sit in today, the North Carolina Mutual Life Insurance building, was one of my first major acquisitions, which was, you know, about $11 million deal.
Right.
And, you know, that seemed like a big deal. It was a big deal, but in the scheme of things, not so much so. Mm-hmm. But for me, coming from where I came from, mm-hmm. you know, but it's not like you get $11 million. No, you know, it's like, it doesn't work like that. You're gonna find investors, you're gonna go to the bank, Bear Stearns, right before the credit markets uh-huh. tanked. We were one of the last loans that they did. You find equity investors, you find tenants to lease the space. And when you exit, when you sell a property, usually, is when you make the money, or you redevelop it to a point that it generates cash in the way of operating income. That's the good stuff. That's
now,
what you
what
like
made you
to do.
Take interest in acquiring the properties in downtown Durham?
Because I saw that there was a boom that was about to happen. Mm-hmm. I was being brought in by developers and businesses to help them build relationships. Mm-hmm. They were hiring me for my marketing and my PR services. Mm-hmm. And it was like, okay, that's great, but how do I get in?
Mm-hmm.
And they don't let you in.
Right.
I mean, that was why the Greenfire development opportunity was such a rare moment. I acquired with my marketing partner, a guy by the name of Jim Patterson.
Okay.
We had a marketing firm called Webb, Patterson Communications, which was located on Paris Street. We bought the historic Mutual Savings and Loan Bank building next to Mechanics and Farmers Bank, and we moved our marketing and PR firm there. And that was when I started to understand how to get in the game. Once I did that, they gave me an opportunity to participate in the discussions of how downtown Durham was going to be developed.
Oh.
Then there was another site at the corner across from the 21C Museum Hotel, which is another project I eventually mm-hmm. became an owner in. But now where you see the One City Center, tallest building downtown Durham, I acquired that land along with a group of partners. And then we sold that land into that development. And that was the catalyst for starting to shift the energy along what was known as the Black Wall Street.
Okay.
So that's sort of how I got started. And then with Michael Lemansky, the founder of Greenfire, he was buying up everything. And I'm like, who is this dude buying up all of downtown? And what is this about? And he saw me making strategic moves, and he assumed that I was like competing against him. And I
was. That's the guy that was at the awards banquet.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. And so eventually he and I started, you know, talking, and we started talking about what would our projects look like if we collaborated, if we okay. worked together. And quite frankly, he was the first person ever to offer me an opportunity to participate as an owner. And that changed a lot.
Right.
So that's the difference, is that most of the folks that you work with in the development field, they might like you mm-hmm. and have you around, but they don't often, you know, allow you to
be an owner.
Yeah, they don't. And so a lot of this is rare, and usually the projects are going to be some challenging projects mm-hmm. when you do get in. They're not going to be the easy ones.
Right. Now, then we came up with Provident 1898.
Right.
And what was the vision? This facility we're in right now, Now Church, is a tenant here.
And I am so happy to
have you. And we are glad to be here. I mean, it's what was the vision behind this? I know I thought that that you were doing it for, because you had an office at your house. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like I'm doing this interview with you and I'm still
learning.
It's like, are you the interviewer or are you asking questions trying to learn? Because I've always, again, one of the intriguing things I find about you, we have a friendship, we have a relationship, but from the business side, I always find out about Carl Webb from other people. You know, we talk about the Tar Heels,
Yeah.
I mean, one of the things that we talk about, and I'm still praying, and I might turn my plate down this week and pray for you, your Dallas Cowboy. When you come into the gym and you have that hat on, and I'm just like, am I going to speak to him today? And then,
you finally got a quarterback. Let's put it that way.
Did they sign him today?
No, you did.
Oh, fine. Yeah. Well, we got to see how good his arm is.
Well, Cam is going to do big things there, and I'm glad to see him there. But Dak is going to be fine. And yes, I am a Cowboys fan. I'm not fond of the ownership, but I'm definitely fond of the players on the field.
Especially when y'all win and you take your hat off in the gym and you show it to me. But that's for another day and time. I don't want anybody to know you like that.
Right, right.
You're taunting the man,
the
guy.
Yeah, there are times when you're not so proud to be a Cowboy. But it's like that you can't win all the time.
Yeah, but you know, during this, America's I'm finding team. Out stuff about you, because like I said, one of the things that I respect, I mean, I have the utmost respect for you, is I've never known anything about you outside our relationship, unless I'm at awards banquet that you know. I'm like, what? Mm-hmm. They had a kid at 10 and like, when did this happen?
Yeah.
You've never told me that. And so I'm enjoying this because I'm learning stuff myself. But we're in Provident 1898. And so what was the vision behind this building? The old North Carolina Mutual building.
That's right. You know, this is a historic building. NC Mutual is a historic company, has been around for now over 120 years.
Wow.
Was founded by, you know, John Merrick and Dr. Aaron McDuffie Moore. And actually there were seven original members that came together to form this company in the year of 1898. And
that's where 1898. Okay.
That is where the name comes from for Provident.
Okay.
North Carolina Mutual. The original name was North Carolina Mutual and Provident Association.
Wow.
And they were founded in 1898.
Gotcha.
Chartered by the state of North Carolina in 1899.
Okay.
And when we started thinking about how to redevelop this property, but mm-hmm. for me, quite honestly, started to think a little bit about a little legacy. Thoughts, what could I do to make a difference?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the real estate projects that I've been involved with, we didn't have a lot of black tenants and businesses that were of the scale and size that they could operate mm-hmm. in there. And I also knew that for a lot of African-American entrepreneurs, business ownership was going to be the way to go.
Okay.
I mean, the kind of wealth and success that we want for a lot of us, not all, it's never going to come from a job.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to give back.
Wow.
And so Provident was that opportunity to do that. So we took what was the cafeteria and the auditorium
okay.
back in the day of NC Mutual, And we said, hey, let's make it a co-working space. Let's create all of these small offices and work environments for the next generation of entrepreneurs and creatives. And let's sort of lean into the history and the legacy of Black entrepreneurship by doing this in the home of the epicenter of Black business, North Carolina Mutual. Yeah. And so that was the genesis behind Provident. I am fortunate in having a partner, co-founder, Peter Savelich, a young guy who is a brilliant guy and has the energy and the youth that I don't have. Because you know what you learn in business is that they're gonna be a series of plethora, really, of things that you can't do well. Huh. And so you really need to find and build a team out of people who can sort of fill those gaps of in those areas that you're weak. And Peter was just that person for me. We had, you know, come off of what was almost a Great Depression, really the last major recession that we had. And, you know, it took a toll. We lost a lot, lost a lot from a development standpoint. Mm-hmm. And had, again, found myself regrouping. And Peter was that guy that God sent me to stand next to me to provide some of the technical expertise that I needed to rebuild. And so we decided, well, we both wanted to do something to give back. Mm-hmm. And so that's what Provident has been. Now, this has not been easy. You know, you're talking about, you know, millions of dollars that we've invested in this on the hope and the belief that that God will bring a return, and we know that he will, because we are both people of faith and we both have lived experiences where it has happened. But what you find is that, you know, not everything that you do will get the kind of support from everyone that you think when you need it. And you know, I didn't know that we would have a doggone pandemic, nor did I know, you know, a few weeks before the grand opening of this business that we would have a gas explosion only a couple of blocks away from this location. So, you know, we've had some challenges in moving things forward, but, you know, we believe that God will provide, but it's not easy. Mm-hmm. And that's the other thing that I think is important to understand. Every dollar that I've made, I've reinvested it back in the next big thing. I am I am addicted to the rush of chasing the next big deal.
And what do you mean by that? You've invested into the next big thing.
That's what you do. I mean, it's if you don't have generational wealth, if you don't have a trust fund, or you don't have money that your parents have left you, then you're earning it. You're first generation money. And when you're first generation money, you're the first person in your family that people look to borrow from. You're the first person in the community. You're the first person that members of the community reach out to say, oh, you know how it is, we can come to you. And you feel obligated to do it. But you need that money that you've made to reinvest it in other deals. And when you reinvest that money in other deals, it takes time to get a return. And guess what? Sometimes you lose it.
So let me ask you this. So when you're doing that, if you're in business and you're taking that profit, are you doing that right away? Or are you putting that aside, waiting for the next big deal? Or are you working on the next big deal while you're in this business?
Those are all great questions. And I think you really answered your own question, because you're doing all of that. You're trying to keep some powder dry. You know, you'll hear people say, you know, you might ask them to invest in something that you're doing, and you know that they have the money, but they don't have the money for your deal, because they're keeping that in reserve for what they believe is a better deal. So you got to keep some powder dry.
Okay, what does powder dry mean?
Say that means you got to keep some savings.
Okay.
That means that if you make $1 million, you can't spend $1 million.
Okay.
You know, you may want to take $250,000 and you put that away in an investment that you can get to quickly if you feel like you are going to need to get it quickly. Or if you're planning for retirement, you're going to put it in a longer term investment that can just sit there. Okay. But what you're also trying to do is to take some of that money and stabilize your personal situation.
Okay.
Because usually during the time that you're not making money, you've run up debt. You've right. either used your credit cards or, you know, you've got deferred maintenance at home where mm-hmm. you didn't put on the roof when you should have put on the uh-huh. roof, or you need to change out the landscape.
Did the Lord tell you that? Because somebody's looking at our roof right now.
and there's that vacation that you promised your wife. Now, my wife married me on potential. Okay. So that big diamond ring, uh-huh. I had to eventually deliver.
Right.
So once I got to a point that I could
what
deliver.
What year was that?
Hey, It took some time, but I came through. So I had to take some of that money, let her know how much I loved her, give her that. I had to make the provisions for the kids, uh-huh. do the work of the house, and then have enough to ride it out for the next deal to come.
So let's pause right there. I want to ask you a question. So just with your history of you and Miss Bridget.
Yes. 37 years.
37 years. What let you know, because there may be some people who watch and say, hey, I'm a businessman, I want to be an entrepreneur, but I have to get everybody on board. Or it may be some women who are watching the same thing. And it seems like long as I've been knowing you guys, she's just always on board. I mean.
Okay. Right. She's always on board. I tell you. The first person that you have to be able to sell.
Okay.
Is your wife, okay. your significant other.
Okay.
If you can't sell that person, then you don't have a business. Mm. You don't have a deal. Because that's the person that is gonna encourage you, gonna tell you that your stuff stinks when it needs to be told that it stinks. That's gonna be the person that's gonna hold you down, that they're gonna go to work so that you can go out and play Mr. Businessman mm-hmm. while they're bringing home the bacon. Mm-hmm. And they're gonna let your friends and family think that you're getting it done. Now see, I'm in this. Right. She believed in me when she was 15 years
right.
old. You know, I would never let her down.
Right.
But if I can't sell her and convince her that this is where we need to go, then I don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And she knows that. And there have been times when I've wanted to do things that she says, no,
mm-hmm.
and I don't go. So she is really the secret to my success
yeah.
because she's the steady Freddie Eddie.
Maybe that's why our wives get along so well.
Yeah, they
whenever
do.
Whenever they see each other,
I do.
It's like
and I really, in all seriousness, I think it is important for, you know, men and women mm-hmm. To find the right kind of partner
absolutely.
to go through if you want to be in relationship.
Right.
And I was fortunate. And the reason that we've spent, you know, our oldest daughter is working on her PhD at Northwestern and you know, she's gone on and she's doing well, but you know, we've been together, Bridget and I, for over 42 years.
Mm-hmm.
So we are partners.
Absolutely.
I'm her biggest fan and supporter. She's my biggest fan and supporter. But you have to be able to sell your wife, cause your mama gonna love you
right,
no matter.
Right.
And my mama loved me.
And she gonna think you can do it.
Not only is she gonna think that you can do it, she's gonna tell you and she's gonna pray for you. And clearly when you are over your head, she's gonna make you believe that she can.
Right.
And that's what my mother did for me.
Right.
Your brothers and your sisters now. No, I got a lot of support. And I'm fortunate in having friends and friends like you that, you know, encourage me. And a lot of people don't understand what I do.
Right.
It's you know, real estate development, marketing, communications. If I'm not talking to you, it's probably because you just don't, you're not a part of the equation.
I remember I adopted this policy that I saw you do. I don't even think you know I saw you do it. And I asked Vic, and I said, Vic, I saw Carl the other day. He said, where was he at? And I said, he's in Chapel Hill. He said, I know where he was. And I said, where? He's at the movies. And I was like, yeah, he was by himself. He said, man, when he needs to clear his head or he's got some deal going on, he said, Carl goes to the movies by himself.
And you're giving away my secret.
And I asked Vic, and I said, Vic, I saw Carl. He's like, and he knew exactly where you were.
Yeah.
And so I started doing that.
Yeah.
I started doing it on my off day. I started going somewhere and sitting in a movie where my mind can just drift off into something different. I can do something different. And that's why I said I watch you and I listen to you and I watch how you move. I watch how you do it, spirit, soul, and body. I was like, man, he's always working out. Yeah. You know, he's and so I watch a lot about you. So this is like a blessing to me because questions that I've always had as I learn more and more about you through Vic, nine times out of ten.
Very good friend.
And you guys have always been really supportive with me. You know, a 29-year-old man doing men's ministry. And
you were doing the thing.
And you guys just helped me out and found Miss Brown and she organized it for us and we gave money to the Durham Rescue Mission. Then we did Woodlawn 1 year. So that's just the things that I appreciate about you.
Yeah.
So talking about wealth, and I hear a lot now, multiple streams of income. Well, how do you feel about that?
Well, I think it makes sense to create multiple streams of income. And even in Provident, with what we do, we have memberships for those that we call side hustlers.
Mm-hmm.
We are creating a side hustle academy.
Okay.
And those are folks that are...
Really? What's that going to look like?
Well, it's going to be weekend training programs.
Okay.
It's going to be creating membership plans that are after hours and weekend kind of access because they have a job during the day, but they need to break away and start creating their side hustle and growing it to be their main hustle.
Mm.
And so I definitely believe in the idea of multiple streams of income. And that's really, at a very base level, the partnership that Bridget and I have had too, and that she's always, you know, maintained a steady gig while I freestyled and been able to do the entrepreneurship thing and had a lot of success, but I've, you know, had some challenges. By the way, she now has launched her own residential real estate company. So now I am the main thing all the time, and she's doing her thing. But a lot of times when people launch into business, there's this school of thought too that, you know, if you're really a serious entrepreneur, you know, you just quit your job and you just sort of jump into it and you're 100%. And then there are others who keep that income coming and then they start to branch out and develop it. And I think part of both work and I think the way that you determine what's best for you is based on your risk tolerance. What is it that you're willing to do? And a lot of folks can't give up that steady income with that job to take a big chance on themselves, so they have to do that for a while.
Now, what's risk tolerance?
That means that how much money are you willing to potentially lose if something doesn't go your way, or how much of yourself are you willing to put out there, you know, because you got to put some ego and pride. You know, when somebody tells you your baby is ugly, you take that personally.
Right.
You've built this business model and, you know, I built Provident and I done it up. I got this beautiful art. I want people to flock to it. But if you get critiques and criticism back, you need to learn from that to make your business better, but it hurts when people tell you that it's not exactly what they want and you want to make it better.
Now, is
but
risk tolerance, like pain tolerance, is it according to the person?
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
It is like that. Okay. Risk tolerance is like that. And it's the same thing as cost-benefit analysis.
Okay.
When we're looking at deals, we're deciding if I deploy capital in this way, what is, you know, how much money do I have to put out here for what potential upside?
Okay.
And is the upside worth the projected reward for me to take that much of a risk? Doesn't mean that I don't do it at all. I just may minimize how much I put out there. Same thing when you kind of love somebody and you don't know if you really love it yet. You ain't ready to completely like go all the way in. You waiting to see how she gonna act. Is that kind of thing.
Okay.
But multiple streams of capital or multiple streams of income, you want to have your side hustle, you want to have your main hustle, You want to have the money that you loan to friends, the friends that you expect that will really pay you back with interest. You want to have that money coming through. You want to have some insurance policies in place. Right. You want to have the money that you save. You want to have, at any time, if something breaks down, you have another way of money coming in. It may not be the full amount, but it will be enough to tie you over to the next thing. And so you'll find people that may invest in real estate. They may invest in retail businesses, just like this. I am an owner in the actual real estate, and I own the business within the building, which is a completely separate entity. So that's two streams. Okay. It ain't no income right now because I'm all in the risk stage. This is all investment. I got over $2 million invested in Provident alone. Okay. The building is just in improvements to renovate the building. We spent over $13 million. We've spent more renovating the building on the interior than we did to buy it. So that gives you some idea of what it's worth in the market. You don't spend that kind of money if you don't think it's worth that, but you may not get it. Something may happen. Who thought we would have a pandemic? So I have that, but I also have a hotel that I'm an owner in. Mm-hmm. I also have real estate in downtown Durham that I still have an ownership, small, but still have an ownership interest in. Mm-hmm. So I am diversified. Unfortunately, I'm disproportionately weighted to real estate. Mm-hmm. And that I'm working to change.
Where would you suggest somebody start? That somebody that can't go get a building, where should I start? Like, what would be some suggestions?
But not everybody in building wealth, it doesn't have to be real estate.
Okay.
I mean, you know, it can be right now anything in cybersecurity and in technology. Mm-hmm. Is where you should be. Mm-hmm. All things tech, for me, is where I want to place my money.
Okay.
I am not excited at this particular time in investing in commercial real estate. Mm-hmm. Right now. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in investing in those businesses that will operate in commercial real estate, but not mm-hmm. because things are shifting. Now people are working from home, right. Things are changing. Residential, I like residential.
Okay.
You know, you buy homes, put people in homes. I've had a chance to do some multifamily development as well. That's great. Because that's continuing to do well. Mm-hmm. We're in a market that's continuing to grow. So those are the things that that I'm doing. Simple things, car washes, you know, look at the main street businesses, the stuff that day in and day out people are gonna need.
Right.
Invest in those things and put a little bit of money in it. Don't start out with anything crazy. Right. But if you see somebody, like if Now Church was an investment opportunity, mm-hmm. beyond my tithes and offerings, mm-hmm. I would invest in Now Church because I believe in Nate Davis. Because I've seen you take it from 0 to 100. Mm-hmm. It's phenomenal. I came to the installation service at the convention center. Did you hear what I said? Oh, that's right, you were there. I went to a pastor's installation service who had just started, and he needed to book a convention center. That's phenomenal. Mm-hmm. I've gone to churches starting from zero, and they're asking us to turn around and wave at the empty seats mm-hmm. of the people that are gonna eventually come. You started out day one, you would be a good investment.
Thank you, sir.
So that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for people to invest mm-hmm. in as much as I'm looking for businesses to invest in.
How do you, and I'll let you get out here on this question, when you're saying you and Peter are doing this together, and you were saying the difference in the ages that he is. How do you bridge that? You know, one of the things I do is I talk to a lot of pastors during the day who may not have a church as big as ours, but they've been doing it for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, hey, tell me why you do this.
Yeah.
And I was talking to this guy the other day, and I said, let me ask you a question. I try to make sure I ask somebody that knows more than me two questions a day. Say, hey, I just need 15 minutes of your time. I got two questions. And because he's got some wisdom.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not like, oh, I'm passionate. Okay, let me ask you this. So how do you bridge that gap? I know you were saying with the side hustle you're going to do here. Mm-hmm. How do you bridge that gap where people can like glean from a Carl Webb and like these people that we have. I'm not that old. I'm 46. Sure, but the people that we have doing operations and
yeah, you got a great
and
team.
All this stuff, you yeah. know, they're telling me. I'm like, hey, what's the set tomorrow? Go on Pro Presenter, and I'm like, listen. You got to text it to me. I don't know. You know, Brianna sending
me. I'm
this,
in that club.
Yeah, she sent me this thing. Hey, just go here and log on. And I was like, hey, just screenshot it and text it to me.
Yeah.
So how do you bridge that gap in business? Because I just think you have a wealth of knowledge. This was supposed to be 45 minutes, and I can't stop.
Yeah.
I'm trying to
yeah.
pick your brain within yeah. an hour.
Bridget is telling me right now, shut up.
Oh, this
You're
is
talking
great.
Too much.
This is great.
But let me tell you, it's Peter Savelich, but it's also Dwayne Washington. That is
Pittsburgh Steelers.
That's right, Pittsburgh Steelers, and I love him anyway.
From
everybody can't be a Cowboy.
And he's an NC State.
And NC State guy, but Dwayne has been with us from the very beginning. He and I have partnered together on a number of deals. He's invested in a number of the projects that I'm involved with. So, yeah. Dwayne too. Not only is he involved, and we're involved together in real estate. But he's an owner in Provident 1898, okay. along with Peter and myself. The only way, I'll turn 60 years old in September.
Okay.
And like I said, I started in, 1982? Right around that time, Bridget and I got married, 82, 83. And I should know exactly what year. I can't remember.
I can kind of figure out a little bit because you said Michael Jordan and Sam Pritchard.
Yeah.
And that's when, being from Chapel Hill, 1982, won the championship.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. I kind of figured it out.
And, but I'm in the fourth quarter right now. You know, I'm at the stage of my life that, you know, I started as an entrepreneur when I was 21 years old. I was a father at 16. I've been parenting. We got three kids. I've been married to the same woman, thank God, and I'm tired, quite honestly. I mean, I'm not tired of trying, but I'm just, you know, but I got a bunch of young people that I'm associated with, and some that are not so young, but young at heart, you know, like Doug Spate is a guy that came alongside. Doug Spate is an entrepreneur, a technology guy involved in mergers and acquisitions. He's a third generation entrepreneur. His family is from Durham. He's from Durham. He's, you know, working with me and helping me. Then he brought his network of people, you know, Ed Ross, Frank Pollock, Labone Moses, Aki Gary. Those guys represent part of our venture coaching program. These are seasoned, experienced professionals that have worked in Fortune 100 companies, that when you become a member of Provident, you get access to them. Then God sends me Joshua Gunn, this young guy, hip hop guy, but business guy. Now he's off in Peoria running their chamber, but Joshua comes to me and works with us. And then just my immediate team, you know, Jasmine Bowles, who is the operations manager. Right. Jasmine is fantastic. Mm-hmm. She's brilliant. She is like so much more capable beyond what she's willing to do for me. It's that kind of humility that she sees what I'm trying to do, and she's willing to meet me where I am and help elevate my game. Tivi Jones is a marketing genius. Tivi is young enough to be my daughter, and she reminds me a lot of my daughter. And it's because of that kind of young energy that I'm infused with that I'm willing to continue to push a little bit more. And so the key now is let the young folk who know how to handle social media do what they do. Let the technology piece do what it does. Use the wisdom that I have and get out of their way and let them make it happen. And that's what Provident is. I mean, I'm saying, here are the keys, drive it. I've made the investment. If it doesn't work, it won't be because you didn't have 15,000 square feet of Class A office space with work of some of the most successful black artists that you'll ever find. Right. You know, William Thomas, you know, Sabotage, photographers, you know, we got everything. Now the team and these folk have to take it and make it go. And that's why you look at all of the attention that we've brought with Black Lives Matters, mm-hmm. all of the protests and demonstrations that are going on right now. It is really time to shift that social agenda into mm-hmm. an economic agenda.
Amen.
And so as we make that pivot, I want to make sure that Provident and the things that I've done, success and failure, is something that the next generation can tap into so that they don't have to make the same mistakes, mm-hmm. but they can take the ball and carry it over the line.
Mr. Ware, I'm honored. I can do this all day with you. I love just to pick people's brain. And I can say this personally, I feel like your brain is one to pick. And I want to say thank you. You have been very good to my family since I've known you. To have somebody like you and Vic mm-hmm. to believe in somebody, a 29-year-old who's just learning what to do and being in the room with you guys, and you guys still letting me kind of spearhead the thing. I mean, I'm honored. I love you. I love your wife. I love Vic. I love Jerry. But y'all have been really, really good to me and been good role models for me to look at, to see the fruitions of things that you guys started. And I think this is going to bless a lot of people. And I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for your support of Now Church. Thank you for making Provident a real thing. And we love you and Sister T deeply. And, you know, don't elevate the treadmill so high when you're in the gym. You make us old guys feel bad. We know you younger, but you don't have to put the incline so high.
Look, I got to do it. I got a 5-year-old at home.
You got to keep up.
I got to keep up.
But
thank you so much.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Appreciate it.
God bless.
Hey, I told you it was going to be special. I want to thank you guys for tuning in to our first episode of Balls Talk. We talked to a boss today. I hope everybody takes this information. I'm going to take it. I'm going to go home and talk my wife to death about everything we talked about, and she's going to be on her computer. But I just pray it was a blessing to you, and we'll see you again for Balls Talk.